Hi, welcome to a new video. Today we want to talk about the maximum a posteriori estimate for the Bernoulli distribution. I will first give an motivation or an intuition for it, and then we will do the derivations, and lastly we will check our results with TensorFlow probability. So we're talking about the Bernoulli distribution. So we're talking about random variables that can take only two states. And we can consider the example of the weather, which can be good and which can be bad. So the weather, denoted as W, can take the states good and bad. And let's encode them as either 0 or 1. And based on this, we know that W is distributed according to a Bernoulli with a certain parameter theta. And the theta, this was the parameter or like the probability of observing good weather. Now we are looking at the maximum a posteriori estimate. And this is similar to the maximum likelihood estimate, that the problem is we have data. So data, this means, for instance, a collection of observations. So for example, good, good, bad, good, bad, bad, and so on, weather, but no parameters. So no parameters theta in our case. And our task is to infer theta from data D. And earlier we looked at an example of how to do this with the maximum likelihood estimate. And the maximum likelihood estimate, let's put this into brackets because it's not what we're talking about, but the maximum likelihood estimate was given as theta star is the arc maximum over all thetas in the range from 0 to 1 over our log likelihood function over the data, giving the parameter theta. And this led us to a probably really good estimate for our theta, but the problem there was that our estimate is probably overfitted. So depending on how the data is given, if it is pure, if it is some kind of noisy, the maximum likelihood estimate can be a bad guess. So it can overfit. And the problem here is because we are just maximizing the likelihood. So we are just maximizing the parameter with respect to the data, but we are not encoding any prior knowledge. So not encoding any prior knowledge. And that's problematic because we can have this kind of knowledge and then we have to encode it in order to be more sure about our estimate that we're getting out. Okay, and here is the remedy, the maximum a posteriori estimate. But a posteriori, this sounds strange at first. For this, let us maybe derive on how we come to this. And I want to start with the MLE once again. So let's call this the estimates. And here we have the MLE. And if we look at the MLE in terms of a graphical model, then we have the following. So we have a weather random variable, and we observe this random variable n times. And this is our data set. And we have a deterministic parameter, theta, which goes into our model, and this determines or this defines our Bernoulli distribution, and this is the one that we fit. And now if we look at the maximum a posteriori estimate, we are making our theta a random variable. So the key here is theta becomes random too. And we can denote this as following. So we have a theta node, and this theta node goes into the weather, the IF weather observation, and we have n observations, which is again our data set. But here we are having a theta, which is a random variable. And since this random variable is only allowed to take values from 0 to 1, this calls for the modeling of a Bernoulli or of a beta distribution. So we say theta is distributed according to a beta distribution with certain parameters alpha and beta. And these parameters are some sort of deterministic too. We are again fitting for our theta, but we are fitting for it in a different setting. So let's call this the goal or the target that we are fitting for. Okay, so maximum a posteriori. For this, let us examine our graphical model. Let us write down the joint distribution. And the joint distribution is P of theta and all the W's. We put them together into one big W and denote this with the vector here. And this is given as P of the W vector, given our theta, times P of theta, just the standard rules on how these factorize. And here we see we have some sort of probability of the observations given our theta parameter, and we have a probability of the theta parameter. And this is something that we've done before. This is nothing else than the likelihood. And remember, the likelihood is what we fitted in the maximum likelihood. And this is called the prior because this encodes some sort of prior knowledge on a parameter theta. And now let us assume what we are doing next. So since in the maximum likelihood fit, we fitted for the data given our parameter, our goal is now to fit for our parameter given the data. So what we need is we need P of theta given the all the data, and to make it more clear, we also call this the D for the data set. So we could also have called this the D, and this is also the D. And now we see this is essentially the same, a similar distribution just with the flipped arguments, and this calls for Bayes' rule, and Bayes' rule tells us this is nothing else than P of the data set given theta times P of theta divided by P of the data set. But this denominator, well, this is difficult. In a lot of cases, we can't examine the probability of the data set or just the probability of the data set alone. And for this, we are just speaking in terms of proportionality because recall, in the end, we want to take a derivative, or we want to take a maximum a posteriori estimate, and for this is just a scaling factor, so it does not count or it does not care in sense of our derivative. So we say this is proportional to P of D given theta times P of theta. Okay, so now we have our distribution, and we can plug it in. So we have P of theta given data is proportional to this, and let's plug it in. How was our distribution over the data defined? So we have a product going from 0 to n minus 1 over, and here we have the Bernoulli of the ith observation given our theta, and then we multiply this with the beta distribution of theta, and here given our defined parameters alpha and beta. Okay, then let's plug in what is the definition of a Bernoulli. So let's keep the product here, and this is then just wi raised to the power of it's theta raised to the power of wi, and here we are getting times 1 minus theta raised to the power of wi minus theta. And this stays in brackets. And then we have the beta distribution here. And the beta is defined as 1 over the beta function of alpha and beta times beta to the alpha minus 1 times 1 minus theta to the beta minus 1. And again, since in the long term we want to take the minimum, this is also just a scaling factor, and we can also just kick it out here and we get something proportional. And in the end, we have the same expression just without this. So I will just copy it down. And here we go. And then we can delete this here. And what we get is this distribution or this expression. And this is the posterior. This is the probability of the parameter theta given our data. And therefore, we are calling this a big M of the data given the parameter and our hyperparameters alpha and beta. And now we can define the maximum a posteriori estimate as theta star map is the arc maximum over all thetas from 0 to 1 over this nice function. And here we are in the same situation as with the maximum likelihood estimate. It is easier to take or to find this maximum in log space. So we are taking the log again and define the small m of d given theta and the parameters alpha and beta as the logarithm of the big M of d given theta with the parameters alpha and beta. Okay, then we can have our function here. Since we are again have to take a derivative, we will do this of course with the m. Let us start with what the m is defined. So we have an m of d given theta and alpha and beta, which is the logarithm of this expression. So we have the logarithm of the product from 0 to n minus 1 over theta to the wi times 1 minus theta to the 1 minus wi times theta raised to the alpha minus 1 times 1 minus theta raised to the beta minus 1. Okay, so we are applying, or let's put a big bracket here, we are applying the logarithm to this entire expression. So we have a multiplication here and a multiplication here, so we get addition. And also our product turns into a sum. So we have the sum from I is 0 to n minus 1 over the logarithm of theta to the wi plus the logarithm of 1 minus theta to the 1 minus wi plus the logarithm of theta to the alpha minus I plus the logarithm, let's put this in the next, and the logarithm of 1 minus theta to the beta minus I. Okay. Let's evaluate this when we have the logarithm of something with an exponent. This exponent goes in front of the logarithm, and then we get the product from 0 to n minus 1 of wi times the logarithm of theta plus 1 minus wi times the logarithm of 1 minus theta. And there we have to set our brackets in order that the summation only applies to these two components, plus, and here we have alpha minus 1 times the logarithm of theta plus beta minus 1, let's put this again in the next line beta minus 1 times the logarithm of 1 minus theta. Okay, now we have our expression for m, and we can start taking our derivative, because essentially what we have to do is just do the derivative and set it to 0. So take the derivative and set to 0. Okay, so we have to take the derivative of m with respect to theta. So we will start here and propagate our derivative forward. So first, the derivation and the summation changes its orders, so we can move our derivative inside our summation. And then we take the derivative of this expression, so we keep our sum I going from 0 to n minus 1. And here we have a wi, or ith Weber sample, over theta, plus 1 minus wi over 1 minus theta, and set the brackets. And then we look at it again, because something that is often forgotten, we have an inner derivative with respect to theta, which gives us minus 1, so this is a minus sign here. And then we go on, here we have the derivative again, we have alpha minus 1 over theta, plus a beta minus 1 over a 1 minus theta. And then we are in this situation. Remember, this has to be 0, this is the necessary condition for our minimum, and here we can then cross multiply, and we cross multiply in both of these aspects of our summation here, and we have the sum again from 0 to n minus 1 over wi times 1 minus theta minus theta times 1 minus wi divided by theta times 1 minus theta plus, and here we do the same, alpha minus 1 times 1 minus theta plus, so here we also have our minus, and we have the minus here, beta minus 1, or let's make it like this, theta times beta minus 1 over beta times 1 minus theta. And since this again, or still, has to be 0, we can look at the denominator and see that it kind of, like, we can ignore it because we can multiply with it and then on the right-hand side times 0, so it vanishes in a sense. And then we get the following expression, I from 0 to n minus 1 over wi, let's multiply this, wi minus wi theta minus theta plus theta times wi plus, and here we get an alpha minus an alpha theta minus 1 plus a theta and minus a theta beta minus or plus a theta. Okay, then we see this cancels, and here, does anything cancel here? So the theta adds up to 2 theta, but nothing else cancels. Okay, so then let's write this down. This is sum from I 0 to n minus 1 over wi minus theta plus alpha minus alpha theta minus beta theta minus 1 plus 2 theta, and this has to be 0. And then we can expand this brackets, or we can split up these addition here with the negative sign and get two summation terms, and we can bring all with theta together into one side of this this equation and all with the others on the other hand. So what we get is summation from I is 0 to n minus 1 over wi minus a summation from i0 to n minus 1 over theta, and all this essentially stays here. And then we can do a last step. We can investigate the summation here. We have the sum from i0 to n minus 1 over theta. And since theta does not depend on I, this is essentially n times theta. And then we can split up anything that belongs to theta as said. So we have the sum from i0 to n minus 1 over wi. Then we have a plus alpha here. We have a minus 1. And then we have a minus and n, or minus theta times in brackets n plus alpha plus beta plus minus 2. Yeah, here we go. This is correct. Minus minus is our plus. Exactly. And then we can bring this on the other side and divide by this term. And then we have theta is the summation from i0 to n minus 1 over wi plus alpha minus 1 over n plus alpha plus beta minus 2. And this is our solution. Let's make this more clear. This is our solution. This is the maximum a posteriori estimate. And what can we learn from this here? We see that compared to the maximum likelihood estimate, we do not just only have the mean, but we also have the alpha and beta here. And we will see in TensorFlow probability that this allows us to be a little more unbiased towards our estimate. Okay, now we want to look at it with TensorFlow probability. For this, I'm in a terminal and I open up an interactive Python session. Then I will import a package in order to suppress TensorFlow warnings. Then we need TensorFlow itself. And we need TensorFlow probability. Here we go. Then we have to define our true theta parameter since we want to create a data set. Of course, in our inference problem, our estimation problem, we don't know this parameter. So after the creation of the dataset, we will ignore it. I will call it the theta weather true, and we set it to 80%, so 80% chance of observing good weather. Then the weather is a TensorFlow probability distribution Bernoulli with a probability of 0.8. And we can sample the weather. How is the day going to be? And the day is going to be good. Good weather. Okay, then we create our dataset. And our dataset is our weather sampled 100 times. So we will put 100 samples into our dataset. And then we can look at it again and see good, bad, good, good, and so on, weather. And the dataset, of course, since we use TensorFlow, will be a TensorFlow tensor. But for later on manipulations, I want it as a NumPy array. So I will save it as the NumPy array. Okay. And now that we have our dataset, we can look at our estimates. And let's start with the MLE. So call this the theta weather MLE. And the MLE was nothing else as the mean. So we can use dataset.mean and we can look at it and see 0.85. Fantastic. It's a little off, but it's close to it. And the offness here has nothing to do with a non-converged optimum or whatever. It's just related that our dataset is not fully representative for distribution, but this happens in real life. Okay, but what we can learn from it that the maximum likelihood estimate is just really bound to the data set. But now if we want to find the maximum a posteriori estimate, we have to first define the hyperparameters of our prior. This is the alpha and the beta of the beta distribution. And they encode our prior knowledge. And You can choose these alphas and beta carefully to be like close values if you only have small knowledge about a problem. But let's say we know that we live in a region where this chance of good weather is usually within a certain range. So we can model our beta distribution in order to adjust for this. And maybe a good way to start is to set the parameters to certain values, look at the function, and then see if this kind of matches your expert knowledge. And for our case here, let's think of an alpha of 30 and a beta of 10. And this kind of tells us that we have a narrow estimate for the range from 0.7 to 0.9, something in this range. And I think we kind of given a good guess with this. Okay, let's start. The theta weather map is then defined as, first we take the sum of the dataset, then we add our alpha, then we subtract 0.1, and we divide this with the length of the dataset plus the alpha plus the beta minus 2. And if we then look at our map estimate, we see the map estimate is closer to 0.8. So if we look at the true value again, it was 0.8. And the key here is that we are getting an informed or more informed estimate for our theta. And that's correct, of course, because the dataset was not fully representative for the solution. So we added more information, and information in the sense of hyperparameters. But it does not always have to be that the map is usually better than the MLE if we have pure data. I mean, the dataset that we have is just sampled from the original distribution. However, it is really common to have some kind of corrupt or noisy data. And if we then use an MLE, then our fit will be absolutely wrong, because the data is nowhere in time or life representative for the underlying distribution. Okay, so let's think of a corrupted data set, and for this I will set the first 50 values. I will set the first 50 values to 0. So if we look at the data set, and we see, okay, we have the first 50 values are 0, and then we have ones, and so on, our regular distribution. And imagine, since we have a 0.8, so we have quite a high chance of getting good weather, but our data is so corrupt that we did some false measurements here, for instance. And if we then perform the MLE, let me start with the MLE, and let's call this the corrupt MLE. And if we then look at it, at the value, then we see it's 0.42. That's way off from 0.8. And for this, let us then also define the map and the map corrupt, which is not a corrupt map, but the map for the corrupt data. And here, if we then look at it, we see it's 0.51. It's still not 0.8, but we see that our expert knowledge is not driving our estimate way far off from the true solution, since we still have some information left. We are still sure that it should not be that low. And that's where the maximum a posteriori kind of has its advantages.